tax cuts and made a moral case for saying no to those that always insisted on hearing yes to tax and spend. President Coolidge, who was and still is the most unpopular president in American history, had the resolve and courage to say, and I quote, "We must have no carelessness in our dealings with public property or the expenditure, of public money. Such a condition is characteristic of undeveloped people or of a decadent generation." On June the 6th, 2011, I took the opportunity to speak at the County Commissioner's budget public hearing. I encouraged everyone to consider the financial data that suggested it would take at least 5 years for our financial conditions to substantially improve and that monetary decisions must be made on an annual basis that are grounded in reality, not blind optimistic or politically correct motivated assertions that things will get better quickly. The data has not changed much, and unfortunately, current data suggests it will take even a bit longer. I ask everyone respectfully, has your family or your friends or you, has your financial situation gotten easier in the last 5, 2 years or last year? If so, I'm sure you're grateful. Because when you get past all the talk, that is not most people's financial reality. I pointed out at the time there was a $14.3 trillion national debt. And we were and had been in a false economy that was stimulated by borrowing for years. Now instead of a $14.3 trillion national debt, we have about a $17 trillion national debt. On a practical level, this means that every individual in the country owes approximately $54,000 per capita per person. But because everyone doesn't carry their fair share of tax burden or contribute at all, that equates to every taxpayer owing more than $148,000 per person. Everyone that comes before you this evening can speak their mind and say whatever they want publicly, and that's the way it should be. But we are gathered here this evening to have a monetary discussion, and at the core, the issue is simple. We are here to determine how much money to take from individuals first and foremost, who own homes and property, to fund government and provide services. It's that simple. Tonight is a monetary discussion, but that reality gets lost in emotion when people are only passionate and sincere about a monetary issue emotionally because of good intentions and sincere intentions. And I respect that. We as a people now talk about everything under the sun when it comes to addressing problems, but the overwhelming talking point of discussion always comes down to equating to do better and address a problem, we must spend more and more tax dollars. We hear we must invest in our children's future, as if we're not already doing that. It's only $30 or $50 more a year in taxes, but we hear no discussion about how much we're already paying. Or we must increase our tax rate now, because when the county decreased its tax rate from 58 cents to 52 cents in 2009, we did not accurately predict how to collect the same dollar amount in taxes at 52 cents as we did at 58 cents. Should that be a surprise to anyone? Revaluation and revenue neutral discussions should serve as a reminder to everyone that in the real world of economics in free countries, free economies are not always predictable and that markets and values go up and down in cycles. And that's as it should be when people live in a free market economy. Only in government circles and those with skewed points of opinion can conclude and suggest that when we lowered our rate from 58 cents to 52 cents in an effort to still collect the same amount in taxes, and it didn't work out that way, that now if we increase our tax rate to revenue neutral, that is not a tax increase. That is not only nonsensical, but it just makes all informed average people shake their heads, especially when one acknowledges that we are still being taxed at valuations from data acquired in 2008, before the financial bottom fell out, and will be until the 2016 data is used to start reevaluating property in 2017. I apologize because I know I'm going to be about 12, 15 minutes here. And I tried to keep it under 7. What all this means in the simplest terms, the vast majority of us are paying taxes on our homes and property based on market value data that was derived before the financial collapse in 2008. We are paying taxes on values that have little to nothing to do with present and real market values today. Bottom line, the vast majority of us are taxed at values that do not correspond with reality. Think of it this way. The county says your house is taxed at a value of $200,000 since 2008, and they will continue to say that it's worth that until 2017. Because that was its value at the time about 5 years ago in 2008 when they did the valuation. But if you tried to sell it today, you'd be lucky if you found anyone that would be willing to pay $165,000 for it. But you won't hear that part of the equation when you hear those that promote and propose, we're really not raising taxes. All we want to do is establish a revenue-neutral tax rate. Wasn't the objective and purpose in the first place when the rate was lowered from 58 to 52 cents to actually lower homeowners and property owners' actual tax burden? If it was not the intent, it should have been. And although every homeowner and property owner in Alamance County pays property taxes, no matter where they're employed, there is a distinct and very real difference in how money is generated to fund and pay people that work in the public sector versus that work in the private sector. That's just a factual, honest statement. And anyone with the most basic understanding of economics understands this. I'll use the example of a teacher to explain this point because our largest employer in Alamance County is the Alamance Burlington School System, whether you're looking at private or public. They're the largest. I have many friends and neighbors in public education, and we all know that the vast majority of teachers are not motivated by money. That's not why they chose to teach. Personally, I spent a year as a soccer coach and a substitute teacher right here at Williams High School and at other schools within the ABSS system. So I fully appreciate and respect all teachers who have chosen education as a career and as a way to serve the community. It is honorable and it's a hard profession, and most people in the public are clueless what they put up with on a daily basis. And I assure you, I didn't do it for a year for the $70 a day or $69 a day they were giving me, just like these people. They understand, especially when the number one thing wrong in the school system now is law and order, and nobody will call that out. I only use the example of a teacher to explain this point because our largest employer in Alamance County is the Alamance Burlington School System, and it is an institution that is funded by all taxpayers, you know, real estate and other sources of revenue. Consider this. In Alamance County, the median household income, the household income, not individual, household income, is $41,058. the average median income for a teacher in North Carolina, not necessarily Alamance County in all fairness, is $45,947. Bottom line, I just took this, take it up with the Alamance Chamber of Commerce, because that's where I got my information. And if it's wrong, I apologize. I know whatever it is, you're underpaid. All right, bottom line, the average for what you put up with, especially from a discipline perspective at the high school level, and these, well, I better refrain from expressing my opinions in that area, because that's a very frustrating thing for me, for what I experienced and what I went through to maintain law and order, just to have a kid's hand slapped and then, you know, sent back and forth 15, 16 different times. But anyway, bottom line, the average teacher in North Carolina makes more money individually than does the average family in Alamance County, where more than one family member works. That's just a factual data reality. I wish.
Hey, before this gets out of hand, if y'all are not speaking, you do not have a right to say anything. Be quiet until your time comes to talk. You're going to have time. You're going to have all night long if that's what it takes. Wait for your turn to talk.
I wish that everyone before you this evening would disclose if they are a homeowner or a property owner. I wish they would disclose the actual dollar amount they pay the county in tax dollars. I wish they would disclose if they or their spouse or family members make their living in the public sector, funded by tax dollars, or the private sector.
Excuse me.
Oh. All right. And although everyone pays taxes to the county that owns a home or property, there is a very real and distinct difference in how money is acquired by the private sector versus the public sector that is funded by all taxpayers. I wish that I could stand before you tonight and agree with those that suggest there is justification to raise taxes for all the good reasons and good things that they would like to accomplish with more tax dollars, as well as more money these people deserve for what they put up with daily in school. But there isn't, from a monetary or a result outcome reality-based informed position, no matter how one articulates those good intentions. It has been 50 years since the start of the war on poverty by President Lyndon Johnson to radically increase spending. All objective, rational, and non-political financial data suggests that effort is far more likely to be the cause of wealth and educational gaps than the solution. Aggregately speaking, our public education system has gotten worse during that time period, with the exception of racial integration. Segregation was wrong and was amoral. But for that exception, I suggest anyone that has been alive, I'm 53 years old, long enough to observe this change would agree that our public education system continues to be seriously flawed and broken. And our response is to continuously spend more and more money on it and many other broken programs in society. I'm almost done. And relatively speaking, we just keep doing the same thing year after year. I'm sure my opinion is in the minority this evening of those in this auditorium, but I am confident that my opinion is representative of the vast majority of those that pay property taxes and are not here tonight. I respectfully request that you maintain our tax rate at 52 cents and commit to say no to a tax increase at this time. Let's find ways to accomplish what needs to be accomplished without equating that to meaning raising taxes and spending more and more money. Let's all commit to being grateful for what we have, no matter where we're at any particular point and moment in life. And remember that in 2013, all of us in Alamance County live far better than most people around the world, and far beyond the imagination of those living folks who were, you know, first came here in 1607. Let's acknowledge, encourage, and remind each other as we go through tough times today to keep it relative and remember that the poorest family in America today enjoys a standard of living that would have been considered opulent 400 years ago and exceeds that of the majority of people living in the world today. Please have the courage to maintain our tax rate at 52 cents, because at this time, saying no to a property tax increase is the right thing to do monetarily. History has proven that President Coolidge and President Cleveland's willingness to say no to tax and spend was the right thing to do then, during their time. And it served many future generations well, even those that disagreed with him, well into the future, after they were all long gone. Respectfully, I request that one commissioner please make a motion and another one second that motion to maintain our tax rate at 52 cents and instruct Mr. Honeycutt, respectfully, to bring you a budget that will accomplish a 52 cent tax rate, and then each of you vote yes to approve that motion. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak, and I'm sorry I took so long. Thank you.
And what you want to talk about.
Good evening. My name is Tony Forrest, and I want to speak with you for just a few minutes on something that's very dear to my heart, dealing with education. First of all, thank you for the opportunity to allow me to speak, and I just wish I had known I had unlimited time. I'd have certainly come prepared, but that's all right. It's a pleasure to see all of you again. And I just want you to know that I realize that there are challenges before you that are numerous and extremely difficult. We obviously don't have the time to go into the specific numbers that you all know even better than I. The decisions that you make today relative to budgeting will affect the lives of our community for years to come. And I also know that you have more to deal with than just education. My message to you and the message of so many others here is that there is nothing more important than preparing our children for their future. We are all blessed with the opportunity to do the right thing. I'm speaking of prioritizing education for our children above any partisan politics or any personal agendas. I think you are all very honorable representatives of your office. As such, it's hard to imagine anything more important to any of you than ensuring the education of all of our young people. I just ask that you show by your actions that that is so. Because of the economy and the tightening of belts from all quarters, accountability and prioritization of limited funds will be at an all-time high, as it should be. If we can eliminate illiteracy, we can spend less time later on fixing problems that a lack of education generates. And I'm speaking of things like poverty, social injustice, and the need to even incarcerate more of our human resources. Later, as you guys and lady deliberate and put things into perspective, you will have an opportunity to demonstrate to our community tremendous moral courage and to show by your example a commitment to education. We have evolved from a time when muscle dominated brain power in a world where the nimble and creative will inherit the earth. our abilities to learn, our abilities to discover, to improve, to invent, to innovate, and basically to solve problems will dictate success. As we are now trying to compete on a global scale, the emphasis is on our local communities to start teaching our kids early. And that requires a commitment to our schools to provide the means of that education. The commitment cannot be fulfilled if adequate funding is not provided. A major contributor to classroom success is the teacher contact with the student in the classroom. If a teacher can channel the mindset of a learner to look within himself for what he needs, a connection can be made. It doesn't matter whether you're teaching life skills, algebra, or even piano. The teacher is expected to be the conduit or inspiration for motivation. Let us do our best to keep class sizes small, teachers and students inspired, and adequate resources available to both. Know that your community stands behind you and will support you if you continue to show support for our future leaders and the institution of education. Adequate funding is a must. And I thank you all for what you have done and for your consideration of education as a priority for Alamance County. Thank you very much.
To be the one to follow Mr. Forrest, that's for sure. I have to say I got pretty angry listening to the first speaker for several reasons. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm Sarah Walker, and I'm a resident of Alamance County. I live in Elon. I got pretty angry listening to the first gentleman speak because I know that you all wanted us to have unlimited time to talk specifically about the budget, and as much as I love history, we don't need lessons from the Depression era presidents that caused the Great Depression. So if we could ask you all to stop people like me when you're not talking about the budget. And I'm going to keep mine very brief because my daughter has two finals tomorrow. So one of the most important obligations of our local government is to educate our children. And not just because they're adorable and they're cute and they need to grow, but also for our future business and our future citizenship here in Alamance County. As Mr. Forrest spoke, there are many things that happen when children are not well educated. And the reality is that good education costs money, period. We're no longer at the median of our state, and our state, unfortunately, is declining amongst the nation on the amount spent per pupil pretty drastically, and we're no longer even at the median of that. But our education is the bedrock of this community. A well-educated workforce attracts business, and that results in a thriving community. As people move on to another realm, we need more people coming in, and the way to get that is to have a well-educated workforce. All of us have been frustrated if we're at the supermarket and somebody can't make change. Well, that starts in high school. For our students, grade school, preschool, okay, but you're right. But the foundation of being a good worker, I hope, starts even earlier. I'm sorry, I'm a little shaky. I'm not a professional. People with at least a high school degree have a nearly 5% lower unemployment rate than a person who does not finish high school. That goes even lower for those who receive at least a bachelor's degree. So the best thing we can do as business-minded people in this community is to help our students grow. We cannot do that without money. And the gentleman who spoke first said we can't continue to spend more and more money each year on education. Well, I've lived here 8 years now. We have spent less and less and less money. Year after year.
Please hold your applause. Everybody knows. Just give everybody enough time to speak and hold your applause to the end.
Year after year after year. We owe it to our community's future now to invest in education. Each year that we've cut funding in this community towards education, it sends a message that we don't value our own future. I mean, we no longer have the meals to go to after high school. We haven't had those for a long time. These people need to be able to go on to learn a trade, to go to college, to do something, and it's impossible to do with the standards that we've allowed ourselves to slip to here. I'm incredibly grateful that there are men and women who choose careers in service to our community, from teachers to law enforcement, librarians, all of our county employees who have gone without raises for far too long. If I were in those positions, I would just move on. And what happens when our brightest and our best move on to other areas that they can receive more money to help them with their families? At some point, you have an obligation to your family to move on, even if you are called to service. More teachers in our community have fewer than 3 years of experience than the state average in our state. There have been national studies that have been done that even the best teacher in the world, their worst year of teaching is the first year. If we continue to get the newest, granted, most enthusiastic teachers, but we are not able to retain those with more experience, our standards at school will suffer. And they have suffered. And we have wonderfully committed teachers who do not have the resources to do their job and do not have the funding needed to maintain their family standards. So I ask you, I implore you, for our county employees, for our law enforcement, for our teachers, for, most importantly, our children, please raise my taxes. I am a property owner, and I would like to pay more. Thank you very much.
My name is Tara Raggett. I am a teacher and a coach in the Alamance Burlington school systems. I have been a teacher for 7 years in this school system. I hold before me a paycheck from January of 2009 and a paycheck from April of 2013. I am making, with a master's degree, $26.70 more than what I was in 2009. That's because I'm being paid a mentor pay. Without that mentor pay, I would be making $23.30 less than what I was in January of 2009. Our budget has been cut. Those are the hard facts. That's the hard data. As a teacher, I tell my students that if I treat you as you are, you will remain as you are. If I treat you as what you can be, you will become that. Due to the fact that over the last 5 years I have not received a cost of living raise, even though I'm striving for excellence in my profession, I'm struggling to maintain my status as a productive working middle class resident in Alamance County due to the lack of support and vision by the county commissioners. Every county surrounding Alamance has made a commitment to their educators and students by supporting them financially in order for their citizens to be productive and competitive members of this state. Surrounding counties view this support as a return on their investment. Somehow, some way, these counties, some of which are more rural, are finding ways to financially support their educators and students. Yet in June of 2012, we were told by the Alamance County Commissioners that the financial support we are given as a school ranks 6th out of 9th with counties of similar demographics. That's not immediate counties that we're competing with. That's of similar demographics. This statement is the epitome of the Commissioners' lack of vision, foresight, and complete complacency with mediocrity. How are the commissioners helping us strive for excellence and competitiveness in the areas of education, business, and quality of life? From September of 2012 to the current date, stakeholders from Alamance County, which have included business leaders, created a vision for public education. This is a national model that will be used to attain economic and educational excellence. How are the commissioners going to help with this process? We have received very little financial help in the last 5 years. What is the plan for the vision of the next 5 years? 10 years with no vision will not help to improve the quality of life in Alamance County. The current recommendation is to raise the taxes from 52 cents to 55 cents. We need to break this down in bottom line numbers to ensure we are not putting a Band-Aid on gaping financial wounds for the next 5 years. The median cost of a house in Alamance County is approximately $133,000. Even if we use an example of a more expensive house that's valued at $150,000, that means that an Alamance County homeowner is currently paying $65 a month in taxes. With the proposed modest tax increase, that homeowner will now pay $69 a month. That's an increase of $4. From the information in the budget, this is still not enough to maintain our schools, and I cordially invite you to come to my place of employment and take a look at the floor that I teach 400 kids. Look at the surroundings that have not been maintained, improved for 30 years. Let alone improve them or even for us to stay competitive. So again, there is a vision and a plan for our teachers and students. What is the vision and the plan for our teachers and students, the future of this county? I want everybody to hold on to their seats for a second, because I'm going to say something really crazy right now. If the taxes were raised to 60 cents, still below surrounding counties, that same homeowner will be asked to pay $75 a month. That's an extra $10 a month from what they are currently paying. This is less than a night out at a fast food restaurant. If the county commissioners would educate Alamance County homeowners with this bottom line financial information, even an extra 8 cents tax increase is an amount families can budget. I'm confident that the citizens, and more specifically the homeowners of Alamance County, would not fear the dreaded phrase tax increase. Instead, I believe that this increase will be viewed as a return on their investment. The years of citizens fearing a tax increase of several cents is over. It has hurt our prosperity, and it will take years for us to make up for the economic loss. In one of my last conversations with the commissioner, I was told that their belief was simple. Our country is bankrupt, we have a part in the process, and when it finally hits bottom, much of what we have now will be gone. And that is a possibility. But the one thing that never leaves you, that you take with you no matter where you go, and you will have forever, is a quality education. Again, I share with you the quote, if I treat you as you are, you will remain as you are. If I treat you as what you can be, you will become that. It appears through your actions and complacency over the last 5 years that teachers and students of Alamance County are viewed as a burden to the commissioners. We are nothing more than bricks and mortar. The results are a stagnant business and educational community, remaining the same as we were 5 years ago. I ask you that you treat us as the amazing citizens we can be and support us financially as we strive for excellence. Thank you.
Thank you. That's an issue she was quoting with me. That was me that told her that.
My name is Linda Ellington. I am a property owner. Our household income comes from the private sector. My remarks are twofold. First of all, I'm a graduate of our public schools in this county, and I have 3 children in the public schools in this county. And I urge you to grant the current ABS budget request. So would my 80-year-old parents, who are homeowners in this county, and my 80-year-old in-laws, who are homeowners in this county. I believe in these public schools, in our public schools, in our teachers, our staff, and our administrators. Despite all the challenges and the lack of proper funding, by using their own money and working overtime, they strive to do what they do best. They teach. And I'm not the only one that has faith in our public schools. Once again, this state's most prestigious universities have awarded Alamance County public school students the Moorhead Cane, the Park Scholarship, and the Copeland, obviously. Our greatest universities in this state recognize the value of education from Alamance County. It's not going to continue to be the case if we do not step up and start really helping the teachers do their job. I'd also like to educate everyone about the potential for a new funding for education in this county. I would like to urge the commissioners, the school board, and the superintendent to settle their differences and work together to approach a new funding opportunity for our county for education. Recently, the Alamance Community and Health Foundation was created out of the merger of ARMC and Cone. This foundation controls $55 million. The principal of that money will be spent to run the medical center, but the earnings on that money are by the Articles of Incorporation slated to benefit ARMC's service community, which is our county, for health and educational charitable needs. These earnings could be $2.5 to $3 million a year. It is clear that any educational funds need to go where the need clearly is, our public schools. Because no matter what anyone says, any public school, any voucher that's proffered in the House, most of our students, the majority of Alamance County students, have, do, and will attend public schools. Thus, our public school system will affect the majority of Alamance County citizens' lives through creating skilled and intelligent workers who attract industry, which workers are employed, pay taxes, stay out of crime, improve public safety, volunteer charitably in our county, etc., etc. The foundation's board will consist of 15 and may already have 5 or 6 members on it. I'm not sure if any of them have public school children or private school or if they're even Guilford County or Alamance County, but we have got to get the attention of this board. We've got to solicit more public school charitable funding. If the commissioners won't fund the budget request for ABSS this year, which I urge you to do, at least hopefully we can work together in the future to access this new funding. There was a statement made earlier tonight that our public schools are broken. Our public schools are not broken. Our society is broken, and it is our public schools that are holding it together. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Greg Murray. I live in Burlington. I'm a city and county taxpayer. I believe I am an advocate and an activist for the Alamance-Burlington school system, their students, and the families of Alamance County. 19 years ago, we moved to Burlington and we built a house. I'm retired. I worked 38 years for one company in the service industry. 4 years ago, I retired. 4 years ago, when I retired, I decided I'd like to do something. I'd like to do something for the Alamance Burlington school system because I had 3 children who went through the system. I wanted to give something back. So I started volunteering at Southern Middle School 4 years ago. What I do at Southern Middle School was first through ACE, which is Alamance County Citizens for Education, and then currently I volunteer with the Burlington Housing Authority, the RSVP program, which is Retired Seniors Volunteer Program. I work in the media center, the library, and I also tutor some students. I was honored this year that since the beginning of the school year to the end of this last month of May, I put in more than 450 hours volunteering at Southern Middle School. And that's 3 to 4 hours a day, 4 days a week. So obviously you can see I believe in our school system in Alamance County. I still have a daughter who goes to Southern High School. She's a rising junior. I have seen what has gone on in the 4 years I volunteered at Southern Middle School. I observe the faculty, the staff, the administration, the students. And I have observed so much, and I realize what teachers really, really are. They are so much more than teachers. They are mentors. They are coaches. They're in-school parents. And another thing that teachers do in the Alamance system is they have to cover for other teachers because of lack of staffing. So many teachers have to cover for other teachers because we don't have enough staffing. Now, going back to something that a gentleman said earlier about the amount of money that our teachers make, an AP, Associated Press article 6 weeks ago, a national article said that North Carolina is on average $10,000 below the national average salary for teachers. $10,000. Now, another thing, talking about education, we like our kids to do vocations or college, whatever they want to do. But if you look at the unemployment rate for North Carolina, it's 8-9%. The unemployment rate for college graduates is 4%. That should tell us something, how important education is. Now, I just want to talk a little bit about the commissioner's budget as it pertains to this one particular issue. Let me first say that I am all for Title I schools. I really believe that Title I, money from the federal government, helps our schools with poorer populations. They help them with lunch programs. They help them with technology. They help them with staffing problems. They give more money from the federal government for these things. Now, I'm proposing that the Alamance County Board of Education and the commissioners look at this. Now, we have some schools that are non-Title I. I ran into someone recently who I know is a technology specialist at one of our schools in this county. And I mentioned to him, well, I volunteered down at Southern Middle, and we'd like to get about 5 or 6 desktop computers for the library where I volunteer, because the other ones are 12 years old and they break all the time. This gentleman said to me, well, we're lucky. We have a laptop for every one of our students. And I said, great. He said, we're Title I. I said, that's wonderful. What I'm proposing to the commissioners is that the commissioners should set money aside for the non-Title I schools so they have equal access to the same amount of funds so that kids in a non-Title I school get those computers, just like Title I school, or get that extra staffing that Title I schools get. I don't think it's fair that non-Title I schools don't get that. And I believe that the county commission should look at that. I feel that all of our county students should have access to the same technology as anyone in the school system, whether they're Title I or not. I believe that we need to keep our schools competitive, not just with other states, but with the rest of the world. The countries like Norway and Singapore and that giant in the east, China, you know they're taking care of their kids. We need to do the same, or we're going to lag behind. Alamance County is a small cog in the overall educational picture of the United States, a very small cog. But if we break down and other communities break down, the whole system's going to break down. We need to support our schools. Teachers are in the service industry as I was. They serve the needs of our kids, our future adults in this competitive world. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Samantha Jarkey. I'm from Gibsonville. I want to say one thing before I talk about what I'm here in support of, that my salary as a seventh-year teacher with a master's degree is $37,410. I have that memorized. Yes, I do. I'm speaking in support of a 5-cent increase to property taxes. I support pay raises to all county employees, even the folks that work in the county's tax collector's department. I recently disagreed with the tax policy, and they answered my numerous angry and aggressive emails with the utmost professionalism. I also support the tax increase because I believe children in this county deserve the best education possible. County funding directly impacts resources and retaining quality teachers, both of which directly impact student learning. Yet at my school, English teachers are buying classroom sets of novels with their own money, and good teachers talk about leaving this noble profession. Our children and teachers deserve better than this. One of you recently stated that you support $500,000 to buy new vehicles for the Sheriff's Department and also support more money to add another crew to the county EMS. Both are legitimate uses of county funds. Schools have legitimate needs too. The school we all sit in today has been undergoing years of asbestos removal over the summers. However, the county manager is only recommending to allot $250,000 of the school board's request of $750,000 for repairs and maintenance to all schools. $250,000 is inadequate to fix crumbling schools as well as outfit them for technology purposes. The county manager also recommends to allot $1.2 million less than requested by the district for operations. This money is badly needed to pay for things like busing students to the new CTEC Center to expand learning opportunities or transporting athletes to games, meets, and matches. The money allotted to schools by the county is not squandered. Every dollar allotted to education is an investment in our community, and I urge all county commissioners to fully fund the budget request of the Alamance Burlington School District. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Lynn Osley, and I'm a middle school cultural arts teacher. I've been teaching for 28 years. 20 of those years have been in the Alamance Burlington school system, the same system that I received a public education. So I guess you could say that I've been on both sides of the fence as far as education in this system goes. I've been a student, and now I'm a teacher. But I can even go one better. I'm also a parent, and both of my children also went through this system. I've observed education in this system in a number of ways. Education, not only in this community, but in the state of North Carolina, has taken a backseat to the rest of the nation. We are the lowest percentile for pupil expenditures, as well as teacher salaries. It is deplorable to think that we can implement new programs, expand our technology resources, or maintain quality teachers without funding. And yes, I'm a cultural arts teacher, so I'm sure that cutting the arts will be next on the menu, but I'll save that argument for another day. Tonight is about education as a whole. It seems we find it necessary to invest in every part of the community except education. Education is like a flower. A flower can't grow without water. Education is a growing process. It can't grow without funding. And who is affected by this? The kids. We always say it's all about the kids. Is it? The kids become the community. It's a life cycle that never changes. But what can change is how we invest in it. And that's what'll make a difference. And then just on another note, I've listened to a lot of statistics, and I applaud everybody who came with all those statistics to inform us of the state that our educational system is in. I came here tonight because education is on my mind, and it's in my heart, and it has been, not for 28 years, but for at least 45 years. And I myself, I look at my salary and I think, I am bringing a paycheck home, and that's a good thing. But retirement, not looking too far in the future for that. When I should be able to retire at 30 years, it'll probably be 40 if I can outlast that education. Thank you for your consideration.
Good evening. My name is Jennifer Talley. The handout that I'm giving you is so that you can look at the same numbers that I'm looking at. My biggest concern that I want to address, as I addressed last year, is misinformation. People keep saying, we're cutting, honey cut. We've cut. When you look at the numbers for every single department, there is not one cut. And it's not even consistent with if you say, I want everyone to have an increase. I love the staff of Alamance County. I have several businesses. I know many of them personally. They come into our businesses. They do business with the businesses that we have. I pay, someone said earlier, how much do you pay in property taxes? I pay over $70,000 in property taxes a year. I have a stake in this. Absolutely. But I'm probably one of the only people that pay that much in property taxes, and I'm happy to write the check. Every single year, I'm happy to write the check. That's not to say that when I write that check, I expect for the management of those funds to be misappropriated. I expect for that money to be spent as I would spend it in my own business. When I served on the city council in the city of Graham, and we were looking at big contracts, multi-million-dollar contracts, and we're going down the line and somebody said, I don't have any questions. I guarantee you, if you were writing a check out of your personal checking account, you'd have some questions. And I look at that money as if it is my own money, because in my opinion, it is. Every bit of tax dollars that you receive, you have to assume and take into consideration that these people are senior citizens. They're young, hardworking individuals, and they deserve the best appropriation of those monies. I don't want to see the blame game going on, and it just seems like that happens over and over and over again. When our jail cost over $1 million over budget, it's impossible in the businesses that I run that anything that I do could ever be $1 million over budget. It's impossible. Because I tell you, every check that's being written, I'm looking at. Every expenditure that's being done, I'm looking at. Everyone wants to blame the previous tax assessor that left, which she did a horrible job. I have a lot of property, and I know a lot of things that went wrong on that tax assessment. But guess what? She couldn't write a check for $5 in Alamance County. She didn't have checks on an authority, and we need to lay the blame where the blame is. And I am just sick to death of misinformation. You could give, I am for education. I have a 12-year-old and an 8-year-old in the public school system. I'm for education. But if you give them this and this and this, and then the people that are in charge of those monies don't use those appropriately, and they lay off. I mean, in the newspaper last year, you know, there's this big layoff of teacher assistants, 8 in one day. And then the administrator goes out and buys a brand new Dodge Durango and a whole fleet of new cars. You don't want to see that. I don't want to see that. There's plenty of people that don't want to see that. I spend a lot of money on property taxes. And when we talk about education and we talk about cuts, the cuts are only to the requests. They're not. If I look at the numbers that are here that were turned in to the state treasurer's office here, when you look at how much money was in the budget last year for the Alamance Burlington school system, it was $31,155,000. The new recommended amount from Honeycutt is $32,655, a 4.8 increase. So, you know, Tim mentioned this last year. He said, how come the numbers that I have don't match with the numbers that you're getting from the administration? It's because those are budget numbers. They're numbers that you can create. I mean, anybody can cut a budget request. A budget request, I can ask for $140 million, and you can cut that request. Cuts in the budget mean that I spent less this year than I spent last year. That's what a cut is. It's simple. And all I'm asking is that the people that pay the property taxes not take this burden on a loan. all of the people in Alamance County receive services. It is not just the property owners of Alamance County that receive services. Everyone does. And if they talked last year about possibly doing a sales tax increase. That way, everyone who receives services as an Alamance County citizen would pay for those services. If you need to raise revenue in that way, then raise revenue in that way. But it just seems like there's just misinformation. Last year they said that property tax revenues had decreased. Every single year since 06, as you can see, property tax revenues have increased every single year. In the years 2011 and 2012, revenues actually exceeded the budget amounts by $4 million each year. The tax department staff, like I said earlier, the county staff, they do an excellent job in the tax department. I mean, it was a real shame that we lost Gerald York because he was just an excellent tax administrator. And their collection rate is 97-point-something%. They do an excellent job of collecting taxes. But when you look at the total expenditures, they have consistently over the years borrowed money, $22 million in 06, $22 million in 07, $6 million in 09, $9 million in 2010, $10 million in 2011, another $1.5 million in 2012 with either investment earnings and debt proceeds, and in 2013, nothing is planned in the budget. So where's that money coming from? It's coming from the taxpayers. You know, we have debt service, and we had talked about this a couple of years ago, and the county manager was requesting to pay back debt service at like in 5 years as opposed to 15 in order to get a better rate. But you know, when you do those things, you know, as a business owner, you don't pay it back when you necessarily want to pay. I'd love to pay off all my debt in 5 years. You have to pay it off as to when your revenues are coming in. And it just didn't make sense back here in when the economy was being sluggish in 08 and 09 for us to be trying to pay back such a huge debt service, you know, in 5 years. It just didn't make sense. And the money that we have brought in and grown the budget, where's that money? We just can't continue to sustain that. You know, I have a new appreciation for Mr. Smith over here because when he left, we were in the green. We were in the black. We had money. This county had money. This county had a fund balance. And when I sat on the city council for 6 years for the city of Graham, our fund balance is over 100% of our budget. That's unheard of. But guess what? They spend a lot of time looking at every check that's being written, anything that's over budget. You're not going to get a check if it's over budget without someone coming back to the county commissioners and requesting a budget adjustment, and they're going to ask why. And I'm just frustrated with the fact that the expenditures, time and time again, Tim has said, we need to cut in planning. Why is our budget growing in planning when we don't need this? It's increased in the recommended budget again this year. It just doesn't make sense. Expenditures are not decreasing. That's why I'm saying, you know, even though you may be giving education an increase from what they got last year, if those monies are not being spent for the intent of what you as county commissioners wish for them to be spent on, that's a problem. And when I met with the staff, and I'm sure you all know of this, about the $21 million last year, I think it was towards April of last year, that they were saying, well, they have $21 million fund balance. Where did that money go? And from April to June, a lot of it got spent. And then you as county commissioners did a great thing in saying, hey, you need to give us some reason of how some policy of how you're going to be keeping up with fund balance. Because as far as I know, you guys are supposed to keep their fund balance. So I don't understand, as a parent, I don't understand why I drive through a pothole and they got $21 million sitting in the bank. That makes me angry as a parent. I don't understand why each teacher doesn't have a smart board. I don't understand why they're not making the salary that they should be making. Clearly, teaching our children and us having the best teachers around, if that money's not being appropriated to the right place. When I was on the council for the city of Graham, our staff was told unequivocally, you have no opinion other than the opinion of this board. None whatsoever. This, as a board, we are going to make decisions as a board, and you are going to follow those decisions. And whether you agree with them or you disagree with them, they are going to be followed through. And anyone that were to ask you, you would think that administration follows through on what this board decides. And no one board member, regardless of whether they vote for an issue or against an issue, should ever undermine the board as a whole. I just ask for you to look at the numbers, because the numbers do not support for the property tax people, the people that receive a select amount of the services, to be increased. The staff does not provide itemized expenditures by object for the new budget, but I think the county commissioner should ask for this information. It's required when you turn it into the state treasurer's department, but none of that was provided in the new budget amendment as it has been in the past. And what's one of the main things you want to see on there? Salaries and wages. So are the county commissioners going to give salaries and wage increases without even having these numbers on the recommended budget? It's important to look at, especially as it relates to salaries, debt service in relation to capital outlay. The staff did not show a comparison between the fees charged last year and the budget request. How many county commissioners has every single fee that's in this budget memorized in your head? There's no way. It's not possible. Me as a city councilman, every time we get a budget request, it would say, this is what it is, this is what we're recommending, and this is the percentage change. And that's been in previous budgets. It's not in this budget, but that's been in previous budgets. If you look on page 28 of the proposed budget, you'll see that there's not one single department where you say general government, public safety, transportation. Not one of those have decreased or been cut. They have all been, and this doesn't appear to be consistent with the 5% raise. And the county manager's department is increased. He's recommending an increase of 49% in his department. Fantastic. I mean, I think that's great, but I'm a taxpayer, and I do not mind at all paying the taxes that I pay. I just want to know that they're going to spend it like I would spend it. It's a lot of money. It's a lot of money that this county gives out every year, and we need to hold people accountable for how they spend our money as property owners. My last point is where it talks about the property taxes on page 3. Every single year, for some reason, the administration brings this up, that we're not revenue neutral. In 2008, we had a big issue with the reevaluation. It was wrong. Not one county commissioner at that time based the budget, nor did the county manager base the budget on those ballooned up rates. They knew better. They knew not to expect to get those things, to get that money. They had all of these appeals pending. All the appeals were being heard before the Equalization Board. And so every single year it's brought up that we're not tax revenue neutral. But yet in 2010, the tax basis increased by $2 billion. So, you know, in 2008 we had a problem. In 2009 it was getting fixed. In 2010, which is usually the year after everything's fixed that you even talk about revenue neutral, so I don't even know why we're talking about it 4 years later. But I don't understand how we did not get that money. Every single year, you can see in the revenues, the numbers show that we got that money. We got that money every single year, and it increased every single year. So the whole point of being revenue neutral is the amount that it was before the reevaluation, that we are going to adjust for that and make sure that we're still going to receive that same revenue. We not only received that same revenue, but we increased that amount. I just think that we need to make sure that we're holding people accountable. The amounts that are being spent in this budget for things other than salaries, I am all for giving county employees raises. I have no problem with that. I've been saying that for years. I think some county employees have been getting raises over the years because they've gotten reclassifications, which I don't think is fair. I think if you're going to give a raise, you need to give a raise to the employees that are working hard for us, whether he's got the lowest job on the totem pole or he's an executive. But it's not right to misappropriate the funds that we have been challenged to distribute in an equitable way. I appreciate the time to speak.
Well, that's embarrassing. Let's see. It'll reach me. Okay. Hello, my name is Jessica Simmons, and I'm a property owner in Mebane. I have two young children. One is going to be in the eighth grade, and one is in preschool. I'd like to start by talking about a mention in the budget this year on page 3 that states that the tax base in our county has decreased by $115 million. Mr. Honeycutt, you liken that to the decreased collection being due to the fact that all classes of property, real, personal, and public service, have experienced decreases. You furthermore state that the majority of these decreasing values are through property value appeals and now through vehicle depreciation. This makes sense. As Jennifer mentioned, I'm sure that we're not the only citizens in this county who will recall that these decreases are due to the serious allegations of impropriety in the tax collector's office during the last countywide revaluation. But as Jennifer mentioned, that's certainly not the only problem. It's also a problem with the spending itself in general. I was myself one of the individuals who fought and won an appeal for a home valued at an exorbitant rate that no home in the neighborhood had ever sold for. That same home later sold for $25,000 less than I paid for it in 2004, and a whole $15,000 less than the tax value that I had secured in my appeal. So perhaps it's fair to suggest that inflated valuations of property have done more than hurt lending organizations, that they've also led to inflated budgets due to everyone having stars in their eyes, thinking that what should have been worth $1 was allegedly worth $5. Property values went through the roof as everyone was selling homes for obscene profits that they imagined would always be there. And as those values and sales went up, the property collections went up as well. Now that this fictitious investment strategy has disappeared, reaping havoc on our entire economy, one of the consequences is, and will continue to be, at least in the immediate future, deflating property values until we get to a point where they should have been all along, which maybe we're there, maybe we're not. But if we continue to base our budget based on the assessment that the property values are accurate where they are, we're going to continue to be in this hole every year again and again and again. And that's why simply raising the property tax rate and not further making cuts in other areas, not salaries, is going to continue to lead us in the same problem. You're asking for 3.5% now. What are you going to ask for next year? When is it going to stop if all we keep doing is asking for more and more and more? If we interfere with the market by raising taxes to make up for declining values, we get in the way, as we always do, and we'll just end up making more harm than good. So we need to first understand that declining values of property are due to many factors. Foreclosures in this county are decreasing, but they still remain high. So people have cheaper options for the same home as the one for sale by a property owner, which causes decreasing sale prices, more short sales, more foreclosures, and more people neglecting their homes because they feel trapped in owning them. If you raise taxes, you'll enhance this neglect. Some people will simply give up, stop paying, and move on to the next place to live. I'm sure many of us have seen that in the neighborhoods anyways. Another reason it may be declining is due to less disposable income among homeowners. Unemployment may be coming down, sure, but this statistic does not take into account what jobs these people are now working for. Are they making the same amount of money that they made before they lost their job? It also does not take into consideration those people who have stopped looking for work and have simply given up. You mentioned that public sector employees in this county have gone without a raise in several years, and that's terrible. The same thing's true in private sector employees, many of whom are being expected now to pay for raises for public sector employees. And that's just not okay. Many public and private sector employees alike have taken not only a loss of benefits and pay cuts, but they've also been demoted due to downsizing or reassigned to other positions making less money. The unemployment statistics fail to take into account several sessions and people hiring to jobs making the same amount of money as they were making before the recession. If they're making less money, as I suspect a good percentage of them are, they no longer have the disposable income to maintain a property to ideal standards or to purchase new cars at the same rate. Naturally, if we keep things longer without the funds to maintain them, the value decreases, and thus taxable value and the money collected in taxes will decrease with them. Keep in mind that many states don't tax vehicles as property at all, because they're always going to be a depreciating asset. So I always found that to be an unreliable income stream in and of itself. Other reasons for declining property values can be seen as this county continues to focus on developing urban sprawl in the form of new construction while failing to do anything with the areas of existing commercial properties. As someone who hails from southeastern Michigan, the land of Detroit, I can tell you that urban sprawl is very real and it happens very quickly, almost without you even knowing it. University Commons is beautiful now, but as the rates for rent go up, more and more stores are becoming empty and changing hands. You can see what happens when this continues if you look at East Burlington. As the new development moves to the eastern and western corners of the county, closer to the interstate, existing businesses give way to pawn shops, consignment stores, and Dollar Trees. These businesses are not the industry that attracts the upwardly mobile. Thus, the upwardly mobile do not wish to live near them. These areas become tenant-heavy. Landlords often do not maintain rental properties to the same standards as their primary residents, and thus property values decline even further. As the values decline, rents get lower, attracting less desirable tenants, and values decline even more. This is what happens when a community decides to spread more money in certain areas of the county while neglecting others. Small pockets become desirable for a time, but as urban blight spreads, as it does, down go the property values, and in the end, we are left with an unsustainable budget that taxes cannot support. Sure, today, 3.5 cents. What about in 5 years? What about in 10? What about in 20? For those of us who make this county our home, we do not want to see the budget get inflated beyond the means of sustainability, and this is where cuts are necessary. When my family makes a budget, we look at our available resources. We look at income, we look at expenses. If expenses are greater than income, we cut some spending. But we don't go over to our neighbor and try to explain to him why he should give us a few $100 a year to keep our numbers in line. We might ask our boss for a raise, and if we have to, we might cut some more spending. We don't ask our neighbor to give us money because we can't simply create more money for ourselves. We can't always be paid more because we want to spend more. Maybe we have to let our landscaper go, or keep a car longer, or sell a car, or adjust our insurance policies to keep our costs down. But what Mr. Honeycutt's budget is asking us to do is to pick the pockets of all neighbors so that the tax income is greater than its expenses without adequately trimming the budget in the process. I know Mr. Honeycutt does not like to admit that he works for citizens. We've had this discussion in January. I don't know if you recall that. But I'd like to take the chance right now to let you know that all of your employers are sitting here in front of you. And there are a considerable number of us who don't want to simply pay more taxes without making cuts, as if we are a bottomless debit card. And I don't believe that we've looked everywhere for available funds. Why do we need so many SUVs in this county? Why the $500,000 expenditure for vehicles? Are there jobs where cars are not appropriate to travel back and forth that I'm not completely aware of? That seems excessive. I see a lot of big black Suburbans. I see a lot of county cars in people's driveways. Are people required to take these home? Is this a perk of their employment? If so, these are things that could be considered to be trimmed. It could be a pool of vehicles that could be used for people rather than take-home vehicles where we need to have more of them to spread along. Car payments aren't cheap. And if someone wants the privilege of taking a car home at the end of the day, they ought to have that taken into account as a benefit of employment. We shouldn't need to allocate as much money to public health after this year, though, because the health insurance exchanges will be up and running, and they're going to save the day for everyone, right? So once they're up, we don't need to reward the people who are failing to abide by the new laws by forcing property owners to pay anything towards low-cost public health, because we're going to have the health exchanges, right? course, I say this sarcastically because we all know that's never going to work. Why do we need to pay to fund a public transportation van with tax dollars when you can raise the rates for the individuals that actually use that service? Why not tax things like library membership? Other cities do it in other counties. There's no rule that says that people can't pay $5 a year to belong to the library. They get the benefit of computers, certainly cheaper than buying their own. You could raise the rates for the batteries and things that they purchase, the headphones and the damage fees that they pay if they've damaged some materials. If people can afford a pack of cigarettes, they can afford $5 to join the library. You can raise fees for after-school programs. When my children went to after-school programs, I could not believe how inexpensive it was for him to sit there for 3 hours every day after school. So I think it was $42 a week. Extremely inexpensive. That's a potential revenue source. We could raise fees for traffic fines and punish the offenders in the county and not the investors, i.e. the property owners, with raising our taxes. We could charge people for their own health insurance, even if it's $10 a month. The private sector has been doing this for years. That much money being raised can certainly be reappropriated to give people salary raises over time. And lastly, the sales tax increase would make sure that people of all income levels, property owners or not, would pay more, and that would raise revenues for the entire county instead of focusing only on the fluctuating value of people's property. There are many ways to raise money. It'd still make it a desirable place to live in Alamance County. We're attractive as a community because we are inexpensive. It's an inexpensive place to live in a convenient location. There are some well-paying jobs here, but this is largely a bedroom community. And the jobs that come with retail development on the east and west parts of the county, they do not pay a living wage for a family. We're reasonably close to many things here, but there's not enough here to keep people from wanting to leave if it becomes comparably priced to Orange County or Guilford County. And people will leave. To keep it attractive, to keep our property values up, and sustain us as a desirable place to live, we need to keep our property values up and our property taxes down. Not raise them. Raising them will not solve the problem of fiscal hemorrhaging that infects our government at all levels. It will cause people to rethink driving 35 minutes to get to work in Greensboro or Durham, and simply they'll relocate there. And what's more than that, it will reinforce the ideology that when you spend too much, you can just reach into someone else's pocket to make up the difference. And that's not okay. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Robert Shore, and I'm a teacher at Hawfields Middle School. And I want you to know that actually, the budget issue for me as a teacher's salary is not meaningful. And I just donated $350 to my school to cover what would be, I believe, the increase that would be in five houses. My principal income for my family does not come from teaching. And I also happen to know a little bit about real estate investing. Now, I would say we look at some of these things and see where value comes from and how much things actually cost and what has been lost. If we go back to 2000, 2001, before No Child Left Behind was begun, we spent approximately $200 more per student in inflation-adjusted dollars than we do now. Now, that doesn't sound like a big loss then. What's the big deal? As a state, that doesn't seem like a huge issue. But if you look at the inflation rate, one of the biggest costs to the public school system, the public sector in general, is healthcare costs. Therefore, inflation in the healthcare sector has eroded the amount of money and sucked it out of the system even more so. But even a bigger sucking sound, and I agree with a lot of the speakers, is misappropriation of funds. If you look, and it's out of your control, it's out of our control. We have a massive shift in our budgets, in public education, over to administration. This is something that as a taxpayer and as a teacher disgusts me personally. Well, what's happened? No Child Left Behind, and now the new state legislator is doubling down. We have five full-time positions in Alamance County dedicated solely to testing. Every school has removed one person, has official other title, but their sole job is to do testing, usually come with another person. Then there's all the printing costs and all the employee hours that are lost. To compensate for this loss, we've gutted our teacher's assistants and we've reduced teacher salaries by freezing them. Now, I can't see how this is long-term sustainable. If you look at a lot of our younger teachers in the state of North Carolina, they come from other states, they come from other places. They have very high, I'm not in this group, but they have very high student loan issues, things like that. Well, if you're making $30,000-something a year, and you're flexible and you're young, what are you going to do? I'd also like to look at the quality of our teaching. Is there a county in the state that does not have a vacancy for something like exceptional children teachers? We're in a recession. Everybody should be begging for a job. Why are these positions vacant? How many of our teachers, and I'm saying this as a teacher, at the middle school level should have a degree you would think in science, correct? They're called highly qualified, or they should have a degree in history. That don't. We have to take, your principals don't have the choice. They can't sit there and select. They have to take who is there for a lot of these fields. This part is probably going to not make a lot of my teacher colleagues happy. But if you want quality in these things, you're going to have to pay for it. Unfortunately, you guys basically have gotten stuck with a buck for no fault of your own. There's going to be even more money diverted from the system now with all the cuts for the EC, all the teachers' assistants. And I'd like you to picture for yourself for a second. You're a second grade teacher. You have a kid with Down syndrome. You have a kid in a wheelchair. You have an AIG student who's reading at the sixth grade level. And you have 15, 20 other people in the room. Are you realistically, without a teacher assistant, going to go in there and differentiate instruction for all those different people? I just don't think it's possible. Another area we've cut, we no longer buy textbooks, as you know. The state legislature decided they're not needed anymore. Well, they changed the Common Core. Give you an example. In seventh grade now, they teach from the Renaissance up into the modern times. But there's no textbook. Therefore, is the teacher really going to go home, find all the stuff online, and rewrite materials for their low-end student, their middle-end student, and their high-end student for homework, plus all the other things they're doing? And then they have no teacher assistant. We took those away, the exceptional student ones, and I have personal issues with that. We took those away a while ago to differentiate instruction for these people. Is it possible? I mean, I would like anybody, go home, pick Revolutions 1848, try to design a lesson that hits all the different levels and is at grade level. I sat there and tried to Google it. I'm sitting there with college level stuff every time I'm looking at it. It is not a realistic task. The unfair point about all this is it shouldn't just fall on the county. It is not right. It should be coming from the state, and the state should do a lot to cut all this nonsense. Other states have done their waivers to get out of all this nonsense and cut all our budgets and the testing and all the budgets and new. We have all new computer systems in order to do this, but there's nothing you can do about it. I would say, though, and I disagree with some of the speakers, that property values matter. You have to deal with what you have. If you don't invest in education, property values decline. Anybody here who has a piece of property in Alamance County would happily take that same piece of property and switch it out for something in Chapel Hill immediately. Why? Your property values would shoot through the roof. They are covering it. We have less tax base than they do. True enough. But if we don't do a little something to cover the distance, it's simply not going to work. And I'll make a prediction for you. If you don't, and even better yet, the state doesn't, you're going to see among your younger teachers, not my age, all right, we're kind of stuck, but among your younger teachers, first 5 years, you're going to start losing them. First ones you're going to lose are your best, not your worst. You're going to lose them in math, you're going to lose them in science, and you're going to lose them all the core subject first. Then you're going to start losing them in all the other words. And I will tell you who's going to be the first to, it's already happening, who are the first to walk away? And that's something we got to consider. And for me, the biggest issue really is job contentment. I, honest to God, don't need the money. And I will double down on this. I will say, if you put that budget through, forget the $350, I'll write another check for another $1,000 to cover some of these taxpayers here that are bothered by it. to my school to make life decent. I mean, you don't even have the textbooks, you don't have the help, you then, with the teacher's assistance, and then you can't print enough photocopies because the budget's cut. I mean, you can't even steal the stuff from and plagiarize and do copyright violations because you can't afford it on hitting the copy button. It has gotten... What are we going to do? I mean, what are we going to do? Now, jack salaries, and I would say then, yeah, then all of a sudden you can sit there and say, hey, we can select. Your principals can go in there and say, hey, we have 10 candidates, not two or not one. Then they can pick people. That's everybody's concern, is quality education. And also look at funding your schools that are in the most need. It's always the differential is in the lowest economic schools. They don't have as much in general parental support. They don't have as much financial base for each one of these things. Those are the schools that are always suffering. They don't need anything fancy. What they need is adults that care. And my biggest one, if I had to take some budget number that I care about much more, even teacher salary matters to me for my colleagues, but even more so, that you try to cover the difference in losing those teacher assistants. These ladies, generally speaking, make like $12 an hour. They develop relationships with these kids. I cannot possibly think of a better use of tax dollars, taxpayers' dollars. Like I said, I just signed over the check to the principal of Hawfields Middle School. I will happily write another one. It just to be heard and have you know, I'm saying it from the bottom of my heart, I don't want to see this corrode like it is. Thank you.
Excuse me. My name is Brian Boylston, and I feel like I'm at Taxpayers Anonymous. My name is Brian. I'm a taxpayer. My property is worth, for tax purposes, $532,000.
Brian, can you get a little closer?
I pay shortly over $2,000 in county taxes, roughly the same for the town of Elon. I think it ought to be a rule that if you come up here and you issue a challenge at the budget meeting, that you have to answer the challenge yourself. I don't believe that the first gentleman actually managed to do that. I work in the private sector. My wife also works in the private sector. But what I actually came here to talk about tonight was something that I've been involved in for the last 6 or 8 months, and that is the creation of a vision plan for public education in Alamance County. And in October or so, the school board, in partnership with the Alamance Chamber of Commerce, chartered a group of people, about 45 of us, stakeholders from the community, to participate and develop a vision plan for education in Alamance County. The small group that put together the group of folks doing the vision plan, they made a large effort to create a very diverse group. So there's 45 of us, and I went through the list. There's at least 19 parents in that 45. There were 7 students. There were 7 representatives from municipal governments. There were 5 chiefs of police. There were 14 businesses represented, and at least 32 community groups that were represented by those 45 people who came together to develop a vision plan for public education in Alamance County. Something else that those 45 people did was, as part of the work, was we went out and we interviewed citizens from the county. And in total, we interviewed about 350 citizens from Alamance County. All of their responses were brought back. Each one was individually categorized, sorted. I mean, you name it, we looked at it. We went through them all. So I feel like the vision plan, as it is a fairly good representation of Alamance County, at least as best as 45 people could do while still working their day jobs. So I've actually got for you copies of the vision plan. And so there's like 100 pages there, but fortunately, all if you're looking for the meat of it, it's the first 7 pages, okay? And that includes a table of contents and a blank page. So really, what you're looking at is a little bit less than 5 pages worth of vision plan. So I like to just take a few quotes from the vision plan. It's sort of divided into 3 parts. There's a section about what we collected from the county, 350 people that we interviewed. What were their beliefs as it related to public education? What was their vision for public education? So the first section in the vision plan is about the beliefs that Alamance County has for public education. We believe, I quote here, we believe that education is the foundation for individual success, economic prosperity, improved quality of life, and the perpetuation of our democratic society. That's not something that the 45 people made up, right? There were actually multiple cards, interview responses that we collected from the county. Collectively as a county, these are the things that we believe. We believe that education is key to our individual success, our economic prosperity, improved quality of life, and perpetuation of our democratic society. Another belief that we have, and I say we, Alamance County, because we really did do our best to survey as many people in Alamance County as we could, as 45 people could, that Alamance County, bolstered by an excellent public school system that helps its students reach their greatest potential, can become one of the most desired destinations for new business and industry, and the most desired place to live, work, and raise a family. You'll find that same belief reflected again in the actual vision statements. Here's the overall vision statement. Alamance County will be led and served by a public education system that is recognized as best in class and whose growth is driven by broad community support. To continue with the beliefs, we will be recognized as a preferred place to live, raise families, and build businesses specifically because of the quality of our public education system. You know, the anecdotes that I've heard is not so much that people move around for low tax rates. I heard somebody recently, they had a house, nice piece of property in Hillsboro, and they were selling that and moving to Chapel Hill specifically for the schools, right? I think if you close your eyes and you see the vision that's here, what you see is instead is that people in Hillsboro and Chapel Hill will be packing their bags and moving to Alamance County specifically for our education system. And that's part of the vision. The people packing their bags from these other places that we generally think of as having excellent education systems, we want them to come here to Alamance County and believe that and know that the education system that their kids can go through in Alamance County is better, is best in class in the nation. That's what our vision is. That's what the people of Alamance County responded when we interviewed them. We will be recognized as a national model for best in class public education, emulated by other school systems across the country. How many school systems today look to Alamance County and say, hey, we want to be like them? I don't know of very many. So what I'm actually here to ask is to give you a call to action, right? One, I'd like for you to read the first 7 pages of the vision plan. It's not much, it's like less than 10 minutes. 7 pages, one is a table of contents, 1 page is blank, you got like 5 pages to get through. Please read it. A lot of people in Alamance County spend an awful lot of time to put it together. The next thing I would like for you to do is to think about, not just now, not just with this budget discussion, not just with tonight, but think about if this is the vision for public education in Alamance County, what have you done, what will you do, what can you do to help Alamance County realize this vision? As members of the leadership of Alamance County, what can you do to promote the vision, to encourage the vision, to support the vision? I ask the people here tonight, teachers, parents, what can you do to support the vision of Alamance County? Best in class, that's what we're looking for. So teachers, when you're making that lesson plan? Is it best in class? Is somebody from Colorado going to call you up and say, hey, I want to use your lesson plan? Parents, what are you doing to make education in Alamance County best in class? When was the last time you made a PTO meeting? When was the last time you checked your kids' homework? What do you listen to on the radio on the way to school? Bob and the Showgram is hilarious. I'll admit it, right? But maybe news is more appropriate for the ride to school. Best in class, not just in the triad, not just in the state of North Carolina, but on a national level. Vision for public education in Alamance County, best in class, nationwide. That's what we're looking for. So again, I'll ask the Board of Commissioners, county management, in your everyday work, the decisions you make, the priorities that you have, the things you say, the stuff you do, what are you doing to support the vision plan in Alamance County for public education? What are you doing to make sure that we have a best-in-class public education system? Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Arden O'Brien, and I, too, live and, of course, pay taxes in Alamance County. I also teach in Alamance County. I have lived here since 2005. My wife and I moved south. Others before me have spoken in general terms about the need for education. I don't think anyone in this room would say that there's not a need. They've alluded in general terms to the loss of highly qualified teachers to the state of North Carolina, to the county of Alamance. I've got to be more specific. I don't claim the ability to speak for anyone else. Those folks who alluded to the vast majorities of folks whose opinions they represented, I suggest to you that you can seek election. Best of luck. I have to be specific and I have to be personal. I'll be personal for myself. With regard to the loss of highly qualified teachers, this is an emotional subject for me, so forgive me. I moved here 8 years ago to find a job, to find work in a field that I love, my wife to do the same. And it's true, as people have mentioned before me, that we as educators don't enter this profession with the expectation of riches and fame, do we? We do this because we love to do this. I love my job. I'm an elementary music teacher. I have the best job in the county. I have the best job in the state and in the nation. There is nobody that has a better job than me. I love my children, my child at home, my kids at school. I love those kids' families that I've grown to know and love here in the last few years, working at Elon. But despite the fact that I never sought riches and fame, let's confine it to riches, I did enter the profession with the expectation that my wife and I would be able to support our family, which is growing. You can hear one of them back there right now, I imagine. Sorry about that. We did enter this profession that we love with the anticipation that we would be able to support our family. That is becoming less and less possible. That's not your fault. The state of North Carolina has chosen to do a number of things to us, things that we would not have chosen to do to ourselves. I don't blame you, Board. I do want to speak to my personal reality, though. A lot of people have talked about sustainability this evening. Sustainability is impacting me, and it's impacting me now, because I graduated college in 2005. And I work now for the citizens of Alamance County in the state of North Carolina for basically a starting salary. That's not sustainable. I sought out a meeting with one of our representatives last year when it was announced that we would be receiving a 1% raise. He declined two meetings. But in the research that I did leading up to that, I realized that the opportunity cost of staying in North Carolina for my wife and I at the end of the last fiscal year was upwards of $20,000. That opportunity cost increases yearly, and it doesn't increase arithmetically. It doesn't increase by a fixed amount. It increases more and more every year. You understand the math as step increases, which have ceased to be, cease to be. I can't sustain staying in North Carolina much longer. Persons of the board, I don't know you, and you certainly don't know me, but I do want to tell you that you have the opportunity to stem the tide of young, highly qualified professionals out of this county, out of this state. You have the opportunity to say to our people in Raleigh that we here do value what we have. We here are willing to stand and support what we have. We here are willing to make the really difficult decision of legislating a tax increase, if that's what you want to call it. We can argue semantics at any other time. If we need to legislate an increase in taxes to pay for the services that we use and to retain qualified people, that's a difficult decision. There are people that are going to be unhappy with you for doing it. But ma'am, sirs, I say to you that it is necessary. It is by God imperative that you do so. Because to do otherwise is going to allow your children, my children, their children, a second-rate education. That's where we're headed. But I misused a pronoun. It's not where we're headed. If this is the course of action that North Carolina seems bound to go in, if this is the course of action that, by your actions, you support through your voting, then it's not we who will be going down that road. It is you. I will leave here with a heavy heart. I mean a seriously heavy heart. Because I love my kids. I love their families. Two of my children's parents spoke here this evening, for which I thank them for being willing to come out here and say and support what they did. It will be the worst decision I have ever had to make. Being a grown-up is lousy. But I will not allow my kid to stay here in a second-rate system. I will not. He's 2 years old right now as of last week, and I will move him out. We will go. We will find some place where they value me as a professional. And if I can't find a job in my profession, I will leave what I love. That is the worst decision ever. But if I can't live here, I will live someplace else where my kids get a good education. I will live where they are valued, where their teachers are valued. And if I can't be one of those teachers, well, so be it. I'll go manage McDonald's. I'll double my salary. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Anna Buckmaster, and I am an educator in Alamance Burlington School System. I have 8 years of experience in the field of education, and three of which have been here in ABSS. And I'm pretty much speaking because I wanted to offer a unique perspective as to why educators are here tonight. I'm sorry, I'm short. I'll try to reach your microphone. So, there was a comment earlier that inspired me to come up and speak tonight. It was about the median salaries of families as opposed to the median salaries of educators in the state.
The speaker referenced the median salaries of families in Alamance County, however, compared them to the median salaries of educators in the entire state, which I feel is an irresponsible comparison, because the state of North Carolina pays all teachers the same. However, the school systems pay an additional stipend, and that stipend varies from system to system. The Alamance-Burlington school system stipend is not the lowest in the state. Also, it is not the highest. So a more accurate comparison would be to compare the median salaries of families in the county with the median salaries of teachers in the county. And I did a little bit of quick research. And the median salaries of a teacher in ABSS school system is about $35,500. Now, that figure is important because the teachers who are here tonight and who I work with every single day realize the value of a good education, and we are willing to spend what money we make and what money we don't make to further the cause of what we do in schools every day. The men and women that I work with at North Graham Elementary often stay after school for hours with students to tutor them on their own time, pretty much because our class sizes may not be small enough to meet their needs. They do this without pay because there isn't enough money to pay everyone who tutors. Many of the teachers I work with spend money out of their own pockets because they feel that our children deserve an equal, if not superior, opportunity at education as those in surrounding counties. Now, I also want to add that I understand the awesomeness of asking for the amount of money that the school board has proposed tonight. Someone told me once that to whom much is given, much should be expected. And I'm here to say that the teachers in the Alamance-Burlington school system understand that if we were given the money we're asking for tonight, we would be expected to do great things. And the reason we're here tonight is because we want to do great things for the children in our district and for their families and for their futures. We want to provide the best-in-class education that was referred to earlier. We want to give them the opportunities that other children in other districts might get, regardless of where they live in the district or any of those things. We want to ask for the money so that we can do our jobs. And that's pretty much all it is. We want to be able to do the best job that we can because we want to serve you, and we want to serve our children. We want to make you proud by performing to what other districts may have, other states may have, other countries may have. The money that we're asking for will go toward lowering class sizes, which is important, especially in elementary schools, because our children come with diverse needs. Many of them need more individualized attention in different areas, and quite frankly, if we have 25 to 30 kids in our classrooms, we're not able to meet those needs. So we would need to use more funds to hire more teachers so that we can have smaller class sizes. But I think even more importantly, we would need to offer the teachers who go to work every day and who are dedicated to doing the best jobs the chance to experience first-class training and professional development. Our district does a really good job providing what they can with what we have. However, there are opportunities out there that are out of our reach simply because we don't have the funds to either bring people in to provide those professional development opportunities, or we can't send people to do those things. The children in ABSS, or in Alamance County, deserve teachers who are trained just as well as any of the other teachers in other districts. So what we're asking for tonight is for you to fund the proposed budget for the ABSS, for the school board for ABSS, so that we can make you proud and do the best that we can for our students. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Dana Roseborough, and I'm a principal intern at East Lawn Elementary School. I'm currently completing my 23rd year in education, 18 years have been here in Alamance County. My husband is also a teacher. I have one son who graduated from Southern Alamance High School, and I have a daughter at Grove Park Elementary School. I'm asking you to please support the full funding request of the Alamance Burlington School System. This is your school system. Dr. Cox and the school board have followed your request to lower the system's fund balance, but after attempting to make up for the cuts from both our state and federal governments this year, the school system can no longer support its staff and programs without the support of our local government. Our student population is growing, but the budget cuts that are coming could cost our system over 100 positions, increase our class sizes, and have a loss of possibly $672,000 in supplies. The educators in this school system already pull from their own very lean pockets to purchase supplies that are needed to teach their students on a daily basis. I support Mr. Honeycutt's budget and his recommendation of a property tax increase. However, I ask that you think in even broader terms about your support for Alamance County and its citizens, especially its children, and consider how you can fully fund all of the budget requests from all of the departments by re-implementing the 2008 property tax rate. If the current property tax rate of 52 cents created a great quality of life here in Alamance County, then I would be all for it. However, it does not. An 8.8% unemployment rate is not a great return on your investment. Not funding the various departments in our county fully will only increase that unemployment rate. Just as Sheriff Johnson has a problem retaining his employees, this problem also exists for our school system. We are surrounded by more progressive counties with more forward-thinking commissioners who've created much higher pay structures for their employees. So every day, we lose educators to those counties. This is a loss to the entire community. Alamance County becomes the training ground for our new teachers. But after just a few years, they switch and move over to progressive systems where they can make more money. A newer teacher can make almost $200 more per month by going to any of our surrounding counties. I, with my experience, could make an extra $300 to $600 every month. This school year alone, my school has lost one principal and four teachers to surrounding counties. I stay because I'm dedicated to the children of Alamance County. My question to you is, are you? If the tax rate was set back to what it was in 2008, that would give the county approximately an additional $6 million, which would fully fund all departments' requests, including the school system budget, and the pay raise for the county employees, and the incentive for our deputies. For a homeowner like myself, this would equal to about $10 per month. I don't know about you, but I think the children of Alamance County are worth $10 per month. They are Alamance County's future. I don't know about you, but I think the educators of Alamance County are worth $10 per month. I don't know about you, but I think that when I have an emergency, EMS, the fire department, and the sheriff's department is worth $10 per month. I don't know about you, but I think that public library shouldn't cost money, extra money. It should be a public library, and that the parks and recreation should be there for us, and all of our county departments are worth $10 per month. I feel like you were all elected to care for and create a vibrant, progressive county that is focused on economic development, great public schools, which attract economic development, by the way, and provide the services needed by all of its citizens. I've heard it said that when you plant a small seed, you receive a small harvest. When you plant a large seed, you receive a large harvest. Some of you want to plant no seeds. You will yield no harvest. I would hope that you would want the county and the citizens you represent to yield a great harvest. Thank you.
Good evening to the county commissioners. Some of you I know. I'm Emma Marie Curry Austin. I am a product of Alamance County, lived here all of my life, I say except 1 year as a young adult. Product of Glen Raven Elementary School, Jordan Sellers Junior Senior High, till it was closed in 1970, and then transferred over here to Walter M. Williams High School, where I graduated. Left from here, went to St. Augustine's College, and then came back to North Carolina when my father, back to Burlington, when my father got sick in the early 70s and graduated from Elon College, which is now Elon University, in 1976 with my degree in early childhood education. I share that with you that I then married here. My husband is a product of this school system. My husband was a magistrate here in Alamance County and then a local minister as well until God called him home. I then raised our remaining four children by myself as a single mom, putting four children through college on my teacher salary alone. But I stand before you today to say that I went into education not because, as most of you have heard tonight, because of the pay. I went into education because I wanted to make a difference. And the difference that I wanted to make in Alamance County was that we deserve the best. And I felt like I was one of the best. So I came home to give my best here. I'm not an outsider. My mother and my father worked in the mill, Anna Dean. I worked at Lindley Hosiery, Diane Hosiery, third shift, when mill industry was prominent in this area. But my mama said, I don't want you to have that mill life. I want you to go to school. So she made me work in the mill on third shift. And she said, at the end of this summer, you make up your mind what you're going to do. And I made up my mind that I did not want to live and work in that mill before they had earplugs that you heard all night long clanging in your ears, sewing the toes in the holes of stockings. So have I always been educated, college degreed? But I am a product of Alamance County school system. We deserve to give our children the best. I stand before you tonight not to argue with you because I respect you. My father said you give honor where honor's due. What a man believes in his heart about God, that's how he will live his life. And I am living my life so that when these young children grow up, because they ain't gonna be babies always, and I'm going to go to a nursing home because I know that's where my children going to put me. But I want to know that even if everybody ain't going to be a doctor, lawyer, somebody's going to have to sweep the floor. Somebody's going to have to bring me a glass of water. And I hope that when they come through that rest home and they see me and they say, is that you, Miss Austin? And they'll remember not how much I knew, but about how much I cared to see that they get it. And I cared enough tonight to show up and to plead our case, because that's all we can do, is to plead our case and hope that it would fall not on deaf ears, but on not a heart of stone, but a heart that is tempered by a love for mankind. And I have a quote that I want to say to you tonight, and I'm not going to stand here long before you. And it's from Horace Mann, and Horace Mann is known to be the father of public education. And he said public, but one of the things that's at the base of his monument at Antioch College, and it says, be ashamed to die until you have won some victory for humanity. I want on my tombstone, I want people to remember that I was a caring individual, not about mortar and rocks and stones and my house and my taxes, because when I'm old, I don't give a crap about that house. All I want is somebody to come through those doors and bring me a glass of water and give me my medicine on time. And I'm out halfway there. Now we laugh. I didn't mean to try to be funny. I really didn't, because this is serious, really is. But we've got to put into our children and to care enough. You can build all the businesses you want, but if our children are not qualified to work at them, people from outside gonna come here and take the jobs, and we're still gonna be poor. We're still gonna have to take care of them through the social service. These precious men over here who came when my husband was struggling and tried to revive him. The sheriff working out there. I live in a community where drugs is high, and Sheriff Johnson and these sheriff men put their lives on the line for us. Not just education, not just for the police force, but for our community, to care about mankind. When you die and you land over there in a nursing home bed, you want one of these children to walk in there and say, well done. And I hope that tonight, I voted for some of y'all. I voted for you, Tim. Now, I voted for Dan Engel, but you got his place, David Smith. And I voted for you, Tom Manning. And in former elections, I voted for you, Linda Master, because you sat in my office when I was president of the Teachers Association. You came to one of our open houses, and you wanted to know what teachers needed and what we thought. And we told you. And you made a promise that you'd do the best that you could for the children of Alamance County. All of you. And here's the kicker to that story. I'm a registered Democrat, but I voted all Republican. Why? Because I don't believe in just voting because I'm a Democrat or voting just because I'm a Republican. I vote for the person I believe has a heart for mankind and will do the best job. And if that means it's a Democrat, I'll vote for that. If that means a Republican, I'll vote for that. But I'm registered because when I was growing up, they said you ought to register for something, and it seemed like the Democrats was on the poor person's side. And I believe that God said, the poor you have with you always, and I want to help the poor people. But God is going to hold you guys accountable. When you make your decisions tonight on this budget, because I believe in my heart already, you've already made up your mind. You're just doing like my husband used to do me and just say, well, have your say, baby, but you're still going to do what I want to do. And he used to say, now, are you done? And then he gone and do what he wanted to do. But at least you gave us the opportunity. I love you guys. I'm not saying that. I'm not here to bash you. I am here to uplift you and give you prayer and pray that God would temper your hearts. Please do the right things for the children, because they are not just our future. They are our today, because there won't be no tomorrow if we don't help them today. And that is our job. My God-given job is a mission field for me in education. It's not just a paycheck. I feel like I'm a missionary on the battlefield for the Lord to help these children. Because when I stand before my Maker, I'm going to say and hope that he will say to me, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Because I'm going to die, and so are you. And some of y'all's hair is grayer than mine. And what we want to do is to be able to lay your head down at night on your pillow. As I tell people, I say what I mean, and I mean what I say. So when I lay my head down on my pillow, I can sleep and I can rest, and I don't have to toss and turn, because I know I laid down trying to do what was right and morally correct, not what used to a handshake meant something. People's word was their bond, and that's gone now. You could say one thing to my face and then talk about me behind my back as soon as I turn. But I believe that we've got good county commissioners, and I'm sick and tired of people bashing you. But I believe that if you work together with our school board, with our superintendent, with our community leaders, we can have the best community there is in Alamance County. I love Alamance County. I'm not here to tear it down. I want to only see it be built up. And the only way is to work together. And I ask of you to work together for the good of Alamance County and our community and our children to pass what we need to pass to make it work. I thank you for your time.
Hello. My name is Tori Tennant, and I'm glad that I'm falling in on the coattails of Ms. Austin, because she pretty much summarized what I was going to come up here and reiterate. I heard a lot of people come up here with statistical data and information. I have none of that. All I am is, like Ms. Austin, speaking from the heart. I am a graduate of the Alamance County School System, is what it was called when I graduated over 20 years ago, almost 20 years ago. Now I have four children that are now in the Alamance County Burlington School System. I have two at an elementary school level, one middle school, and one rising high school level. I live in the southern part of the county. We're at E.M. Holt, and Southern Middle and Southern High Schools are the schools that my children attend. I did hear a gentleman come up here and speak, and I said, and that was my driving force for really coming forward. And he wanted to say, what was Alamance County's teacher doing to step our game up, to remain competitive? And my reason for being here is because we need those resources so we can do just that, to remain competitive, to retain and maintain the good teachers that make the school system what it is. I have seen, or I see every day when I drop my children off at school and pick them up, the dedication of the children at their school system, the teachers' dedication to the school system. They're driving the buses, they're working in the cafeteria, so they'll get off the bus route, they'll go in, and their teacher students come back to the bus route that afternoon. We got the teachers that are giving their own time to arrive at 7 o'clock in the morning to make sure that there are teachers and students and staff and even parent volunteers in line to let our children out of school, out of the car, so that they can make it to the school building. They're working, and everybody spoke on, no, they're not paid to do over and beyond what they do, and they do it because they love the education system. That's why they got in the business of becoming an educator. And I want us to see Alamance County grow, but knowledge is the key. Knowledge is going to be the power. We have to give the children the resources and funding to promote the education so that the education promotes the growth, not only for the student themselves as an individual and a contributor to society in the future, but for Alamance County as a whole, from the business level all the way down. I've proposed to other parents and spoke in general that how the Chamber of Commerce needs to get together with the school system, and let's talk about business and growth and furthering. And I think if we all, like Ms. Austin said, can work on one accord, we can make Alamance better, Alamance County better for every citizen involved. But as a parent, I know that it is very crucial for the school system to receive the budget funding that they have requested. Lack of funding means lack of something, some type of resource that they're having to go without, whether that be the teacher assistant or that one being able to provide that one extra free lunch meal. The funding needs to be there, no matter how big or how small. The children are our future, and if we don't invest in our future, we have none. Thank you for your time.
Good evening. My name is Ariel Hogarth, and I'm currently finishing my eighth year of teaching social studies at Eastern Alamance High School. I would like to speak in support of fully funding the budget request made by our superintendent and school board. Before I go on with what I read, I'm going to make a comment on an earlier speaker tonight. He said that we have flaws in our school system and we have a broken school system. That kind of goes hand in hand with what I wanted to talk about tonight, because I wanted to focus on a positive. Instead of we're beat down, we need this, we need that, let's talk about something that we have had that I want us to continue to have. And we are not broken. We have flaws, but the number of days that we as educators and our children smile over the numbers of stressful days is higher. We do not have a broken school system, but we have flaws, and that's why we need the funding to continue to move forward. I refuse to believe that we are broken. So I am proud of what I do. I'm proud of what my students do. I'm proud of what my school does. We are not broken, but we do need to continue funding. And now we need more funding to fund more students and more resources that are needed to move forward. What I was going to talk about was a personal experience that was funded from a one-time professional development dollars. Last year, several teachers from across the district were sent to advanced placement certification in a lot of different courses. I'm grateful to have been sent to the training for AP psychology or advanced placement psychology. This upper level course has not been offered in the classroom by a teacher at Alamance High School since I've been there for 8 years now. I'm sure you know that psychology is a basic course that is required in many different fields in college, including education. And our students at Eastern now have the opportunity to take that class, earn college credit, go in with some under their belt, and save tuition money because it's offered at Eastern. Without sufficient funding, our district will not be able to continue this beneficial professional development. So that's a positive that I'm grateful for last year, and I want to continue the funding so we can continue the education of our children. Thank you for your time, and I urge you to fully fund the Alamance Burlington School System. Thanks.
Good evening, I'm Allison Gamp with Alamance Citizens for Education, and I bet you thought you were going to get through this budget system without hearing from me this year, but I do want to just take a few moments to make a few comments. First of all, thank you for this opportunity. It means a lot both to the community and to all of our citizens. As we watch the jockeying of our local budget and the impact that it may have on our local taxes, I am struck by a question: how did we get to this point? I don't claim to be an expert on local budgets, but I do know that Alamance County seems to be very proud of its low tax status compared to those other counties in North Carolina. Why and where has this gotten us? We must first believe that a strong community does and will invest in its infrastructure, but more importantly, in its children. Each child in this community is our future. Investing in them ensures a strong, vital, thriving community. Believing in them is critical. Supporting them is a serious obligation. You and we all here must do that. Did you know that only about 20 counties in our state have a lower tax rate, and three other counties are equal to that of Alamance County? There are 100 counties in in the state. Take a look at these counties and where they fall. Consider their position for economic growth. Of the 20, six are coastal. Tourism is a strong economic driver. 12 are mountain counties, all resting on Tennessee and the Georgia border. And only two sit outside those parameters, Iredell and Moore. And Moore, it is a golf capital of the state and has an abundance of retirees with means. My point is that each of these utilizes tourism funds to offset their low tax base, or they are rural and low-wealth mountainous counties where economic development has been stagnant. Alamance County is certainly not a tourist hotspot, nor are we a poor county. Alamance County sits in an ideal location within our state. But the fact that we continue to believe that county services such as our water and sewer, ambulances, services, law enforcement, schools, Department of Social Services, our county employees, and others can maintain or even move into a competitive market without increases is becoming unrealistic. Even your county manager states, and I quote, tax increases are never popular. However, if you look at the issues that the county has dealt with over the past 4 years, they are sometimes necessary to ensure that we maintain an adequate fund balance, a good workforce, funding for basic public safety needs, facilities, schools, and being proactive with some of our building maintenance. We have continually cut expenses, but we are now at a point where we must be proactive as we move forward. And I end his quote. It's time that we as citizens and our community leaders take a hard look at where we want to position Alamance County in today's global economy. Continually raising and lowering our tax rate, not developing a long-range revenue source, and leadership that continues to believe that Alamance County is doing just fine is truly doing a disservice to all of us. It is important that as citizens we recognize that the cost of living does increase, and with that, the need to improve our county services has to be at the forefront. It will take bold, visionary leadership and a willingness to see that times have changed and to stand firm in the hard discussions that are in the best interest of the citizens of Alamance County. In other words, we can be less political and more progressive. It should not be about elections, but doing what is right and what will bring Alamance County into a competitive market for a new business and industry. The county manager is working with a difficult funding base to try to seek budget solutions. I commend him for that. The school board has presented to you a realistic solution in the form of a resolution. Consider a 5-cent increase, which is only a cent and a half over the county manager's budget. It's approximately $50 a year on the average house property tax of $100,000. Is that too much to ask? It translates really into one fast food meal for only 5 months that we would have to give up. And this could move our community in a forward direction instead of backwards. The future of this county depends on those who believe we can do better and are willing to step up from behind the veil of no tax hike, and it's good enough for me, or it was good enough for me, and lead the county in a bold and new exciting direction. As citizens, if you agree that our county needs to move forward from the status quo, take action. Or if you're content, then do nothing. But I assure you, no matter what your view take is, something or nothing will happen. The children of our county deserve to be prepared and excited about their future, giving them tools, resources, and being an involved community will only make Alamance County a model for the state. I ask you, where do you want Alamance County to be in 5 or 10 years? No department has asked for more than they need. Many have asked for less than what is required. It is your job to see that they get it. Thank you for your time.
My name is Joy Rust, and I'm a resident and a property owner of Alamance County. I'm a mother of 3 children, 2 of whom have graduated from ABSS, and I'm a teacher. But thankfully, my paycheck isn't as meager as those I mentor. But that's because I have a master's degree. I am also National Board certified, and I'm old. This is my 35th year of teaching. I can easily say, though, that I am passionate about children, and I'd like to speak and ask for the funding for the budget for ABSS for 2013-14. As Tony Forrest said tonight, your decision tonight impacts our community for years to come. This is a headline that I have from the May 19th Times newspaper that says, "Revolving Door, Coming and Going." In this article, it compares employee turnover rates as well as starting pay for the Sheriff's Department and compares Alamance County data with 9 counties. The county sheriff's department has a turnover rate of 8% for deputies and 10% for detention officers. Did you know that the annual turnover rate right now for ABSS currently stands at 11%? It often feels like, as those in the trenches feel, that we are a training ground for these counties around us where the supplement is higher. Wake County, Guilford County, Chapel Hill, Carrboro, Orange County, Durham, Winston-Salem, Forsyth. We sit right there between the triangle and the triad, and yes, as we've heard tonight, right in the middle, serving as the training ground. Just like the Sheriff's Department and others, we also want to retain quality employees in ABSS, but we need your help to do that. I suggest that that be one of your goals as well. We're losing outstanding staff members of ABSS. How does that affect our community, you might ask? As families decide whether to move into our county, especially families with school-age children, they research the schools, like what I did in 2000. Especially families with those school-age children, if they like what they see, they're going to consider settling here in Alamance County. We would like to think that they will purchase a home here because of the schools, rather than go to those neighboring counties. We want our schools and our kids to be competitive. I would like to think that we're not going to settle for mediocrity. I ask you, as you heard tonight, does your vision for Alamance County include making our county attractive to even the graduates, the children of ABSS, to consider returning here to live and to raise their families? Like previous speakers, I ask you, what is the vision that the commissioners have for Alamance County? Earlier tonight, we heard about the vision for public education in Alamance County. I, for one, am not content with mediocrity, ordinary, fair, or average. I like the idea that was mentioned earlier tonight, best in class. I would hope that we would all want, as we've heard so passionately tonight, the best for the children of Alamance County. Every day, we ask the kids to do their best. We tell them to strive for the best. We don't accept less than the best. And I ask that we also consider providing the best for our children. I ask that you show by your actions that you want the best for our children. I ask that you help us to provide the best that we can for the children of the county. This is what the employees of Alamance Burlington School System try to do every day. And I am imploring you to help us because we want the best in class for our kids. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Lisa Ward. I teach in the Alamance Burlington School System. I went to school, grew up in Mebane, went to school through our system, went to college, came back, also got a master's degree. I'm also a National Board Certified Teacher. Came back to our system, and I've been to, certainly in 25 years, I've been to more than one of these sessions, and it is always appreciated that you do let people speak out and you listen. I do not have a lot of statistics. I did not really come prepared to talk tonight, but I don't have a whole lot more opportunities before I retire to actually express some things. I have seen a lot of the things that you've heard tonight. I have often felt as a teacher that we are a training ground for new teachers, especially from other places, and that they often leave. I think we've had some excellent teachers come here, even for just a few years, that have helped us. Diversity is good. We want people not just from Alamance County to stay here. We want more people to come here. Growing up in Mebane, being in classes, I never thought, I studied about the Eiffel Tower. I looked at pictures and portraits that were painted. I never really thought I would see any of them, because I thought I'd just stay here in Alamance County all my life. But I have been to Paris and seen the Eiffel Tower. I've been to London and I've seen original paintings by the people that I studied. And that's part of what I try to impart to my students in Mebane now. We are global. You can grow up in Alamance County and Mebane and travel the world and see things and learn things and come back and be a better person, be a better citizen. That's something that I think is a gift to give our kids. I can tell you, I've just looked at my tax returns for the last 4 years. Every year my salary has decreased. I don't have any budgets. I don't know what you want to call a cut. I do know that I make less money and have every year for the past 4 years. I have more students in my class than I've ever had, and I have less resources to teach them with. Now, where that all happened at, I don't know. But I'm asking you as commissioners, when there is something you can do to help out with our school system in any way, we all benefit by it. My father was in the hospital a couple of years ago, and he passed away, but five former students helped my father, my students that I helped teach. Over here in this side of the room, I've worked with the EMS people in my health education program. I'm proud to say I've taught two or three of the guys sitting over here tonight. When we work through education, when we help build our students, we build our community. We all benefit from it, not just our kids. We all benefit from it, and we're all benefiting from it for our lifetime. So again, I ask you that in any way that you ever can help with education, it helps us all. It makes us all better, and I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Larry Conti, and I am a teacher at Newland Elementary School, and we appreciate you giving us an opportunity to speak tonight. But I wanted to chat with you a little bit about the heart and soul of education, the things that most people don't see, but I get the blessing to witness every single day. We have teachers who give their time, who give their clothes, who give their money, who give their hearts and souls to kids every single day with asking for nothing in return. Teachers who run after kids who run out of the building. Teachers who get bitten, who get spit on, and still come back and tell those kids they love them and they got a new day tomorrow. Teachers that on a snow day when their kids are not coming to school but yet deliver gifts to those children's house on their own time and do it without anything in return. Teachers who tutor after school, before school. Teachers who work 365 days a year and are never off. The teachers that are called to this thing called education do not have a day off. They work in the summers. They work on holidays. They take work home every night. They sacrifice, their family sacrifice, for their ability to give back to kids. It is a special calling, education. You can't put a price tag on it. It's an insult to put a price tag on the miracles that they perform every single day. As witness to the team here today, I'm so proud of Newland Elementary School and the work that those teachers do, and every teacher. Our teacher assistants are paid little to nothing, but still give unselfishly every single day to children. It is amazing what goes on in the school. I wish you would spend some time in the school building and watch the miracles that go on every single day. Our leadership in central office has done a phenomenal job cutting and doing the things they need to do so that our teachers are prepared and ready to go. We're asking you to please work together, come together as one team to make decisions that are best for kids. But your actions are going to speak for you tonight. So please, we pray for you. We hope that you will make the right decision and do the right thing. Our teachers in this county are phenomenal, and it is a shame that we lose some incredible human beings to counties right across the street, and it's just sad. So please, we appreciate your time tonight. Thank you guys for everything you do and your commitment to our community and our county. I am also a taxpayer in Alamance County, pay county and city taxes, and I wouldn't mind paying a ton more. If it's going to support kids and help us, then we're in that. So again, thank you so much, and we appreciate your time tonight.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. My name is Henry Vines, and I'm from Snow Camp. I come tonight, there's a few things that I would like to ask y'all to consider. One of the things that has already been discussed tonight is the fact of the increases that are in the budget. The county manager's office has a 49% increase, which results in about $778,471. That is the largest increase of anything on here other than human resources at 27.8%. Our total increase over the county is 11.4%. We look at our school system, and it's only 4.8. We look at our sheriff's department, it's 2.8. I find that these numbers, with the county manager's office being that high, I would certainly ask you to ask why. Also, on the raises for the county employees, we're looking at the county manager's proposal is 5% for increases across the board for county employees. I would see you do this in a certain amount of like $2,500 per employee. It's not fair to an employee that's making $30,000. It only gets at 5% gets a $1,500 raise a year, when a $100,000 employee in the upper management will get $5,000. I don't think that this is fair when we're looking at trying to adjust for loss of income that we have failed to give our employees cost of living raises through the years. I think it would be much more fair to everyone on a set basis. And on our retention of our sheriff's department, I feel like that's the same thing, that it shouldn't be on a 4% rate. Because, again, where is it needed? Where is the retention needed on the sheriff's department? In the deputies, in the detectives? Where are we losing these? I think this needs to be studied. And if our salaries are too low to compete with other counties, that should be put in for a salary adjustment, not just a raise arbitrarily at 5% or 4%. And I'd appreciate it if y'all would seriously consider this and look at this. And I thank you for your time.
Thank you to everyone for speaking tonight. I apologize for being late. I thank Commissioner Lashley for beginning the public hearing. For John and Tony and Linda and others that spoke initially, I was able to gain the content of your remarks, and I appreciate what you said as well. If there are no other speakers at this time, I would like to entertain a motion to close the public hearing. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second? David, thank you. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Public hearing is now closed. Commissioners, on the agenda at this time is item 4, discussion and possible approval of the budget ordinance for fiscal year 2013-2014. At this time, I'd like to open discussion for any comments the commissioners may have.
Well, twice it was brought up tonight about Honeycutt's increase in this, and you want to answer that? We asked that question.
Yes, sir. That increase is really all fixed costs. That is employee health insurance, the increase in that, the unemployment insurance increases from the state, also the state-required mandated reserve for unemployment insurance that went up $300,000. And also the increases to the health insurance for our LME retirees and also our retirees for county employees. So it's not the county manager getting a $400,000 increase. But they're all fixed costs that are part of it. But the other costs within the budget has not increased.
You said when you explained that it all had to go under your...
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Tim. Other comments? I'd like to respond just in general to what I heard tonight. And not only do I appreciate everybody speaking, but I really appreciate the courtesy, the cordialness, if that's a word, of the way tonight's budget hearing was held. Sheriff, you didn't have to get involved in anything. That's always a good thing. I was a little concerned, though, by the number of comments that I heard about folks, frankly, bashing the school system. Folks that allegedly were supporting the school system were calling the school system second rate, calling the school system flawed. Yes, it has flaws. We have flaws. All of your companies that you work for have flaws. But calling it broken, I think that's a little strong. And I can tell you from personal experience, there are a lot of good things about the school system, and there are a lot of people that work in their school system that work very, very hard, regardless of the funding sources, regardless of the environment around them. We have good schools, and we've got good teachers, we've got award-winning programs. Get Dr. Cox to explain the Little Leaders program to you if you haven't heard about it or you're not aware of it. Go judge some of the senior projects. Go see what those students are putting out as they near completion of their time here in Alamance Burlington. I'll tell you, my two children went through Alamance Burlington right here at Williams High School. My stepchildren are here now. There are good programs, there are good teachers, and everybody works hard. My point is that when you call our school system second rate and you say things are broken, these messages are carried. And the perception's out there, and if it gets carried long enough, if people think that our school system's broken, they're not gonna be real wild about supporting it. And I heard the same discussions tonight as I heard the years that I was on the school board about teacher supplements, about being competitive with neighboring counties. And we do wanna be competitive. But I think we need, every time we point to bashing things within the school system, I think we also need to show our support for what's right in our school system. 22,000 students plus that are in our schools right now, we hear the horror stories, but we don't hear all the good. And I would just ask you to consider that when you're touting the word about our school system. The second thing I heard tonight was it seemed to be education against property owners. And I don't think that's what it's about either. I think it's about quality of life. If you look at the amount of funding Alamance County puts toward public education, it's the highest percentage of anything we fund. Sheriff, not counting the DSS transfer money, you come in second, right? But it's a far second. So our commitment, this county's to public education, this county's commitment to public education over the years, I think has been strong, it's been consistent, and it's been with what we had the resources to provide. In my opinion, long term, the key to successfully funding education at the levels that I heard about tonight have to do with increasing the property tax base. What can we do to create that environment? I've said this many times, where businesses will want to locate here, expand their employee base, and thereby contribute to our property tax base. And calling our system second rate is not the way to do it. A report just came out last week about our latest unemployment. And it was touted as declining. It was declining to 8.6%. This is as of April, the last figure we have. But what that figure doesn't tell you is that in April we had 73,000 people working. 73,000. In June of last year, we had over 74,200. The unemployment rate in June last year was 9.9%. Now it's down to 8.6%. What's the difference? We have less people unemployed. We don't have more jobs. We have less jobs. We have less people unemployed because they gave up or they moved away. So we're not in a slowly increasing economic environment. And I will say to you, those that criticize the school system, those that say they're not being funded enough, we need to put the hat on that talks about what we do for Alamance County and the money that we are able to provide the school system, law enforcement, and all the other services that people want. That's just troubling to me when I hear that. If you get your, when you get your next vehicle property tax bill, take a look at it. On the right-hand side, it shows where all the money the county collects, how it's distributed. You'll see where education falls. You'll see where DSS falls, and law enforcement, and the libraries, and Parks and Rec, and on and on and on. So I think it is important to have the dialogue that we had tonight, and I appreciate all the comments and all the different opinions that are out there. But I think in the final analysis, when we, particularly our own educators, are bashing our own school system, I think you need to take a really closer look at what you're really saying. We talk about teachers leaving this county to go to other counties. How about all the teachers that come here from other counties? How about all the teachers that leave here to go to other counties and then come back after 3 or 4 years? We have a good school system, we have the right size school system, and we have very, very hardworking teachers and administrators. That's all I'm gonna say about that.
Good.
Other comments?
I have some problems with the manager's proposed budget, and I cannot vote for a 3.5 cent increase. I think Jennifer brought up the issue of cutting, and I've been remiss, I'm sure, because I was looking at other things, but she hit home with me on it. And I look at all of the different departments and I see increases, 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 and more increases in this budget. And I think I need at least more time to go over this, and I think we need to really get serious as a board and not leave everything to the manager and make some decisions on our own and do some more.
Are you making that as a motion?
Well, not yet. You got
okay. Okay.
The county's fiscal position is as weak as most of you out there know, but we didn't get there in 1 year. It took several years for it to do, and we're not going to get out of it in 1 year, and there's no reason in the world for us to think that we can, and there's no reason to even try to do it. I think one place we can cut is the $1.6 million for the fund balance. Just suggestions. I think we can cut $1 million out of that, and we'll still be showing that we are improving, and if some of our other cuts come forth, and we should be over the 8%, I think, at the end of this year and hopefully the end of next year easily. That's just one suggestion. That's almost 1 cent on the tax increase right there. And there are others, and I think...
For the group, can you explain about that formula a little bit, the 8% requirement and the pressure?
The Local Government Commission, which is a division of the State Treasury Department, requires counties to carry a fund balance that is not designated. It is money there that can be spent in case of emergencies, and the counties, they require 8% of our total budget to be in a fund balance, undesignated. Now, we have more than that in our fund balance, but a lot of it is designated, and we can't count that, and the county just received this year a notice from the LGC, Local Government Commission, that they were concerned because our fund balance, undesignated, the money that can be used if we have hopefully never a tornado or an earthquake or something coming through here, that fund balance has to be 8%. And they'll give us some time to get it back. I think it was 7.86.
8.3.
Is that correct, Craig?
7.83.
Yeah, that's what our fund balance is or was at the end of last year. We're hoping that that's going to increase this year because we did institute some cost savings for the last quarter, and hopefully it will come about. But I think we have more pressing things, and we need to cut the manager's proposed tax increase as much as we possibly can. Again, I like to go back to, and I think one of you out there mentioned the revenue neutral from the last revow, and we did not go to revenue neutral. We went lower than the revenue neutral, and as the speaker said, we did not bring in enough money. I have also, after looking at more figures on the proposed budget, I have some real questions about estimates for revenue coming in. I like to always be very conservative on revenues, and some of them look a little liberal, to say the least. So those are my suggestions. I really cannot, in all honesty, say I'm ready to vote tonight.
Let me, if I could broaden that statement and maybe suggest that any of the commissioners that have line items like that could maybe pass that information on to Craig in the next day or so.
Be glad to.
We have, Craig, correct me, but we can review this at our next meeting for possible approval, which will be 2 weeks from today. That is a morning scheduled meeting at 9 o'clock. Would that give you, Craig, the time to take the input and review it?
Right. The question would be, would you like a separate workshop to discuss items as a board, or would you like to just give me the information individually and I'll compile it? It's up to you.
I would like a real workshop. I don't think our budget workshop we had was really in depth enough. I mean, the five of us have got to get down and just get into these figures and get our hands dirty with it and make some real decisions. That's the way I look at it. Now, I'm just one vote here, but
How does everyone else feel about that?
Well, my personal belief is the majority of this board needs to make a decision on how much they're willing to raise taxes, if any, and then tell him to do it. Tell him to make it work. That's my personal belief.
Well, I understand what you're saying, Tim, but it's kind of passing the buck. I want to know what.
I'm not going to pass the buck. We debated this all year long.
Do, quite frankly, and I haven't heard that.
Revenue neutral, for instance, back when that was said, I didn't vote for 52. I didn't vote for that budget. That was 4-1 to go with 52. But there's things out there that we know we've got that we can cut if we want to cut it. I mean, everybody's talking about raises. That's fine and dandy, but they don't tell you that there's $900,000 a year being paid in longevity pay every year. They don't want to talk about that. There's all kind of things out there that we can look at. But if you will, I'm not going to vote for tax. I'm not going to vote for a tax
suggestion.
I'm not going to vote for a tax increase. Are you going to vote for a tax increase? Are you willing to vote for a tax increase?
I have no idea at this point. I thought I knew what I was going to do, but I don't.
All right, we'll meet again.
But I'd love to hear your suggestions. I may agree with every one of them.
Well, and maybe the format that our county manager is talking about would be helpful for that. Would the majority of the commissioners be receptive to having a meeting either late this week or early next week and discuss the items like David's talking about?
I think I would. I know I would.
Daytime.
I'm fine with that.
What did you say, Tim?
Daytime.
Daytime?
It'll have
to
be.
Can we get something scheduled like that, Craig?
Would you like a morning meeting or?
Tim just said daytime.
Daytime.
We can make it a week from today?
Well, we can. Let's talk
about it. Okay. Well, but would you like the chairman to call that, or would you like to make a motion to call the meeting, or?
Well, I think by consensus we can just say it'd be good to have a work session. Isn't that what you're suggesting?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's. I'll be out of town Thursday and Friday.
Well, we can get Tori to do her thing and schedule it. Is there then consensus or a motion to not proceed with any vote on the actual budget at this time? Is there a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Dave. Any other discussion about that? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, at this time then what we will do is not take any further action on the budget or the tax rate tonight. We'll ask county manager and his staff to schedule a time for the commissioners to meet. Certainly that will be a public meeting with proper notice. Would invite anyone that can attend that to do so as well. Is there any other business to come? I'm sorry, any other commissioner comments or any announcements? Anything else to come before this board? Bill, again, thank you for kicking this off. We stand adjourned. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.